This is the 2019 BMW X7, and it's BMW's new full-size luxury SUV with three-row seating. Now, the full-size three-row luxury SUV has been around for quite a while. Back in the 1990s, you had the Lexus LX and the Lincoln Navigator and the Cadillac Escalade. And then in the 2000s, the segment added the Mercedes GL and the Audi Q7. But BMW has resisted entering this market until now. Now, the X7 has arrived. It is officially on sale. And today, I'm going to review it.
I've borrowed this X7 from a viewer who just got it from Crevier BMW, which is the largest BMW dealership in North America. Crevier BMW gets everything first and newest and best, and that includes this X7, which has just gone on sale here in North America.
Before I dive in, a little overview. Now, the X7 is just coming out for the 2019 model year, and it will be BMW's seventh SUV. Think about that. It's just crazy, especially when you consider that just 20 years ago, BMW had zero SUVs. But the market has spoken, the people have made it clear what they want, and what they want is SUVs, and especially luxury SUVs, and BMW has been happy to accommodate. Now, this car's closest rival will be the Mercedes-Benz GLS, but other rivals will include the Lincoln Navigator and the Audi Q7 and the Range Rover. The X7 is offered in two versions, both of which come standard with all-wheel drive. This one has the entry-level engine option, which BMW calls the X-Drive 40i for some reason. It's a turbocharged six-cylinder with 335 horsepower, and it starts around $75,000. You can also upgrade to the X-Drive 50i, which is a turbocharged V8. That one has 450 horsepower and about 480 pound-feet of torque, and it starts around $92,000. That's big money for an SUV, but then this is a big, luxurious SUV. And today, I'm going to take you on a tour of it. First, I'm going to take you all around and show you all of the quirks and features of the new X7. Then, I'm going to get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'm going to give it a Doug score. And for more of my thoughts on the X7, click the link below to visit autotrader.com/oversteer, where I've also compiled a list of the best certified pre-owned BMW bargains currently listed for sale on Autotrader. All right, I'm going to start the quirks and features of the X7 with the back seats, because probably a lot of people who are interested in this vehicle are interested in it because of the back seats. So I'm gonna start with the third row, and specifically accessing the third row. Now, to get back here, you pull up on this little plastic tab on the second row, and then everything else happens automatically. The first thing that happens is the front seat moves forward automatically to make room for the second row seat. Then the second row seat moves forward automatically, the bottom moves forward, and the backrest folds forward in order to provide as best possible access to the third row as you can. Now, obviously, this takes a little longer than a regular car where you just pull on the seat and move it forward, toss it out of the way, but it's all automatic to get into the third row. Anyway, now that you've folded forward the second row, there's actually a pretty wide opening, quite a bit of space to get back into the third row. Obviously, third rows are generally intended for children, but I am an adult, and I just climb right in with no problem. It's actually surprisingly easy with this seat folded so far forward. Now, before I get into the quirks and features of the third row, I want to talk about putting down the third row, which is something that you can do from right here, from this little panel next to the second row. There are two individual switches that control the corresponding sides of the third row seat, and you can push the switch to fold down the third row. And when you do, first the headrest folds down, and then the seat itself automatically folds down, and you can push the other switch and do the exact same thing for the other side of the third row seat. When it gets better, because you can also use these switches to fold the third row back up. If, for example, you're trying to load someone in and the seats are folded down, you don't have to fumble around with latches or reach in. You just press these buttons in the other direction, and then the seats fold right back into place. No latches or manual labor required here. Although, when you fold the seats back up, the headrests don't go back back up, so you have to manually put the headrest back into their locking position, but I think you can handle that. But anyway, now I'm back here in the third row, and I should mention that one other benefit of those little switches in the second row that let you drop the third row seats is they have them on either side, the passenger side or the driver's side, meaning it doesn't matter which side of the car you're on, you have the same raise and lower the third row functionality. But anyway, next I want to move on to the quirks and features of the third row, because usually in most cars, the third row is kind of a penalty box where you stick kids for short trips and they spill their juice. But in this car, the third row has an enormous amount of stuff. For example, under this little panel next to the third row seat, you have a USB-C, so you can charge stuff, and you have that exact same panel on the other side, so there are two separate chargers back here in the third row. Obviously, you can see there are also cup holders, one on one side and one on the other side for your third row passenger. But it goes well beyond that. This vehicle also has heated third row seats. Now, you've heard of heated second row rear seats. This thing heated third row seats, not a common option, but the X7 has it. And as you probably saw next to the heated seat control, the third row has its own climate zone, which is truly incredible. This car has five climate zones. Each of the front four seats has their own climate zone. They can set their own temperature and fan speed to however they want. And then the third row has another climate zone back here. You could have heat in the first two rows of seats, and then air conditioning on back here. And if you're wondering where the climate vents are for the third row, they're on either side above the third row windows. You have one climate vent on each side, which actually blows quite a bit of air if you have it turned all the way up. Now, another item I want to turn your attention to back here in the third row is the quality of the seat. Take a look at this. Quilted leather, beautiful stitching, and right in the middle, you have this piping. This is hand-woven piping that some person in the factory actually weaves by hand. Now that's a beautiful look, but it doesn't come standard in this car. In fact, it's only included with the BMW individual interior that this car has, which is a $5,000 option, and it includes a lot of stuff. If you look throughout the rest of the interior, you can see the two-tone dark blue and white. That hand-woven piping is on every single seat. It looks absolutely gorgeous. You also have little BMW individual script on the door sill when you climb in, and the key says BMW individual to let you know that you've chosen a special personalized component to your BMW. Basically, it's just stitching and high-quality leather all over the seats, the interior everywhere, and it even includes a blue suede headliner that goes from the front all the way to the third row. But maybe the most impressive item, at least to me, is the fact that the third row in this vehicle even has its own sunroof. Now, a lot of full-size SUVs have panoramic sunroofs that cover the first two rows, but this takes it a step further with a special sunroof just for the third row passengers. You will not see that on pretty much any other vehicle. Now, the sunroof doesn't actually open, but you can open the blue suede headliner cover, and then you're getting light into the third row, and it makes it feel just a little bit less claustrophobic than your typical third row. And speaking of sunroofs, another interesting feature of this vehicle is something BMW calls the Sky Lounge Roof. And basically, it works like this. When you drive around during the day, you open the sunroof and you get a lot of sunlight. But at night, the sunroof doesn't have much function, so BMW decided to change that. There are ambient lights built into the sunroof, and if it's nighttime or you're in a garage, these lights turn on and then they give the sunroof a glow. And obviously, you can configure the color of this glow, and so your Sky Lounge Roof makes the sunroof interesting and exciting and colorful even at night. And speaking of ambient lighting, another very cool feature in this vehicle, I showed you this in the new 3 Series and the new 8 Series, but it's worth showing again. The door panels have little ambient lighting strips on them, and you can change the color to reflect your mood inside the vehicle, but the moment the door is opened, those light strips turn into red blinking lights that alert approaching drivers that you have a door open. And it's the same deal for the back doors. They have ambient lighting that looks very nice, catered to your mood, but then you open the door and those ambient lights actually turn into a safety feature, this red blinking light that lets approaching traffic know that the door is open. Now that's pretty cool, but here's the especially quirky part. I already showed you that the third row in this vehicle has basically everything the first two rows have. The seats, the sunroof, the climate controls. But it also has those ambient lights. They light up and they show mood. And when you open the back doors, they also blink red, even though they're not open. They're not alerting any traffic that a door is open. Those are ambient lights inside the third row. For some reason, they still blink red to warn other drivers of impending danger that doesn't really exist.
But the best part of the ambient lighting is just how comprehensive it is. Look at all this ambient light. This is one of the most impressive displays of ambient lighting you'll ever see. Basically, every surface has nice mood lighting, and of course, you can configure the color to whatever shade you want and whatever brightness you want to see when you're driving your X7 at night.
And next we move on to the cargo area of the X7, and to get back here, you open up the top tailgate, and then there's also a lower tailgate. And the theory there is it provides you a nice little picnic bench if you want to have a picnic out the back of your X7. Now, as you can see, the cargo area back here is fairly small. Obviously, with three rows in place, you don't have a lot of room to put stuff in here, but you can change that very quickly. There's a series of switches over here on the side of the cargo area, and they control all of the seats automatically. Now, that's not all that special on its face, because a lot of cars give you the option to press a button and drop the third row of seats. But the X7 takes it to a whole new level.
For one thing, if you press the first row of buttons, you can move the second row seats forward and up to allow for maximum cargo storage, although they won't completely fold flat. Press the second row of buttons and you're controlling the third row seats, and you can drop them for a flat load for or bring them back up all automatically with these buttons.
Now, that's all pretty cool, but there are two more buttons back here that are also worth mentioning. One says max with a passenger on it. If you press that and hold it down, it basically moves all the seats and puts them all back in the maximum passenger configuration. If you press the button that says max with the luggage on it, it basically moves all the seats and folds them into place for a maximum amount of cargo back here. So you don't have to hold down each seat button individually if you want to fold all the seats down and get a large item in here. Just press max cargo, and they automatically go into that position. And since I'm back here, one other interesting item in the back, even the cargo cover in this vehicle is a nice, luxurious blue suede to match the headliner, and it also says X7 on it, reminding you which vehicle you've chosen as you load in your cargo. But I want to move back to moving seats for a second, because I'm not quite done with it yet. Check this out. If you're sitting in the front seat, in the driver's seat right here, there's a little button on the driver's door panel marked rear. You can press that button and automatically move the rear seats, the second row, forward or backward at your choosing. And you can go onto the infotainment screen and select whether you want to move both seats at once or whether you only want to move the seat on the passenger side or on the driver's side, meaning you can start moving the seats around while you're just driving down the road in this thing. It's pretty impressive. And since we're talking second row seats, might as well climb back here and go through the quirks and features of the middle row in this car. Now, as you can see, these are captain's chairs, two individual seats back here. A regular bench seat is actually standard in the X7, but you could pay $600 extra and get captain's chairs, which in my mind is actually a pretty good deal. Obviously, it separates your kids from fighting back here, and if you pay the $600, the captain's chairs are power operated, so you can move them forward or backwards with a little switch on the side of the seat, just like you could in a front seat. Now, additionally, if you get the captain's chairs option, in the middle of the two seats, you'll have this big plastic tray that has cup holders in it, and it also has a very large segment of the plastic devoted to an X7 badge. Just again to remind you which vehicle you're in. Now, the second row captain's chairs have a few other interesting quirks and features beyond that, and I want to start with the headrest. Now, they have regular old headrests, but you can see that clipped onto them, there is a pillow, and it is a very soft pillow, and it is a very nice place to rest your head. You get that with the individual interior, like I said, $5,000, but it comes with pillows for the second row seats. Worth it. Another interesting quirk back here, the captain's chairs in the second row come with these armrests, again stitched in beautiful blue, and you can stow them by just putting them down. They go away if you don't want an armrest, but if you do want an armrest, they're adjustable. You can move them forward or backwards just in case your arm is a little too long to handle the regular armrest in its normal position. And next up, we move on to the front of the X7, where there are quite a few interesting quirks and features. I want to start with the windows. The windows in this vehicle are dual pane all around, all the windows. It's something that only really high-end luxury cars tend to have. Obviously, it keeps out sounds better than standard windows, and I can tell you already, this is a very, very quiet vehicle, and I'm sure those dual pane windows, which are standard, have an effect on that. Now, next up, obviously, this car has a giant center infotainment screen, which I'll get to in a minute, but it's worth noting that the climate controls have their own separate screen, which I actually like, because then the climate controls are always in place. You don't have to go through various infotainment screen menus just to find out what your fan speed is. If you turn the climate controls completely off, that screen just goes dark, and then it stays dark until you turn the climate controls back on again. Next up, on either side of the climate controls, you have buttons that turn on the heated or cooled seats. And interestingly, this button can do either thing. If you press the button, it remembers whatever you had on last, and then it turns that on. But you can also go into the infotainment screen menu that pops up when you press the button, and you can switch on the other thing. And you can see when you do that, that the little lights above the heated or cooled seat button, they will change color from blue to red, depending on whether you are currently using the heated or the cooled seats. Next up, another interesting item in this car, this beautiful high-end $5,000 interior is perfectly complemented with a $650 option that gives you glass controls. And you can see that especially includes the shifter, which is this crystal see-through shifter with an X right in the middle. But it isn't just that. You also have this crystal glass control for the volume knob on the stereo, for the engine start-stop button, and for the iDrive controller, all of which look just a little bit more beautiful than your standard control. Now, next we move on to the tech features in this car, and one of them is the fact that this vehicle has air suspension, and it has 5 different ride height settings. Obviously, right now you can see the car is on its normal air suspension setting, but if you press this little switch in the center console in the middle, you can raise or lower it at your whim. And here is a very sped up version of the X7 going from its highest possible setting to its lowest. Now, you can see when the X7 is in its lowest setting, it basically looks like a lowrider. It's essentially sitting on the tires. It's just absurd. But the theory here is this is an entry height. So if you want to make the vehicle a little bit lower so someone who has trouble climbing in can have an easier time climbing in, that's when you would move the car into its lowest possible suspension setting. Now, next up, another impressive technology feature in this car is its automated driving feature, its self-driving feature. Basically, this car can drive itself at speeds below 40 miles an hour, and you never really have to put your hands on the wheel. It can do it all if you're going under 40 miles an hour, but you have to pay attention. You have to be looking ahead. And how does the car know that you're looking ahead? Well, there's this little camera mounted in the gauge cluster screen area that looks at your face. And if it senses that you're sitting down texting on a laptop, on an iPad, it will beep at you and send you warning lights and tell you to take over, because then it knows you aren't paying attention.
Those warning lights come courtesy of these lights on the steering wheel, which light up with orange when it's time for you to take over. As you can see here, I'm completely letting the car drive itself, and the system works well. It steers, it brakes based on the speed of the car in front of you, and it's generally excellent, but it only allows full self-driving on highways below 40 miles per hour. Basically, if you're in heavy traffic, bumper to bumper, it'll drive itself. In other situations, like above 40, or if you're on surface streets, you have to tap the wheel every 20 seconds or so to let the car know you're ready to take over at any moment, or else those steering wheel lights turn on and it gets angry.
Now, speaking of that gauge cluster screen, I've covered it in greater depth in my review of the new 3 Series and the new 8 Series, which I will link in the description below, and you can check out those reviews if you want to see more about it. And the same goes for the infotainment screen. I've talked more about that in those videos, but I do want to cover a couple of highlights here, specifically the camera system in this car, which is the best camera system in the car industry. The thing I like the best, of course, is this 3D view thing, where you can basically look at the car from the outside of the car and see exactly where you are relative to where everything else is at any given moment. It's a brilliant feature. I especially like these little colored boxes that will light up green, yellow, red to let you know if there's an object nearby that it has sensed in your path. It's a really, really good feature, and this camera system is just truly incredible. Truly the best in the car industry, bar none, right now. One other interesting feature related to the camera system is something called Backup Assistant. I demonstrated this in my review of the new BMW 3 Series, but I do want to show it again because it's so crazy. Basically, the way it works is you pull into a parking spot. Let's say it's it's a tight parking spot and you're nervous about pulling out. Well, if you press backup assistant, it will remember the route you took to get into the spot, and then the car will automatically take that same route to get out so you don't have to do anything. And when you press backup assistant, it displays exactly how many feet it remembers, and then you can let the car do its thing. And right now, you saw me pull into this parking space. I'm not touching the steering wheel at all. The car is backing me out of the parking space automatically using what it remembers of the path that I took to pull in. At some point, backup assistant then turns off when you're out of the space, and you can take over and drive from there. One other interior item I should mention, I will always question the sanity of any automaker who puts the power tailgate control on the door panel right next to the window switches and uses the exact same design for the power tailgate control as the window switch control. I could just see myself accidentally press that while I'm driving down the highway, and then I open up the tailgate by accident. Hopefully there's some safeguard to prevent that, but I don't want to try, and it really shouldn't be in that location. And finally, it's time to discuss it. Let's do it. Let's talk about the grille. Now, the grille has been the biggest point of contention with the X7. A lot of people think it looks really ugly, too big, too massive, too ridiculous. Personally, I don't really think it's that big of a deal. This is a bigger BMW, and so they have to size up the grille to match the size of the car. We've seen this with Ford pickups, we've seen this with the Cadillac Escalade, Lexus, even Mazda's grille gets larger when it's on an SUV. It makes sense. And actually, when you see the car in person, you think, yeah, okay, maybe it does look a little bulbous and a little cartoonish, but what's the other option? Should they have put like a tiny little sedan grille on here and then you have all the rest of this as blank space? This seems like the best they could have done. But regardless, since you're going to complain and get angry and get mad, I will give you a couple of seconds alone with the grille and then we can move on. Okay, let it all out. Now next we move on to another interesting item in the front, and that would be the fog lights. If you look at the front of this vehicle, it almost looks like it doesn't actually have fog lights. They're mounted basically as low as they possibly could be, but they are there and they are powerful when you turn them on. The other thing I want to talk about with this car's styling is, aside from the front grille, I really like how the X7 looks. I think it has a very handsome design, just looks like the X5, which already looks good, but made larger and not in a weird or stretched out way, but I think the proportions in this vehicle actually do look really good. Now, this car's biggest competitor, the Mercedes-Benz GLS, hasn't really had a completely new clean sheet redesign since it came out. It's only kind of been tinkered with and updated here or there, but I think this looks a lot more modern and a lot nicer and frankly a little bit better than its Mercedes-Benz competitor, if you can get past the grille. And so those are the quirks and features of the new BMW X7. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the X7. My first observation in here before driving it was just how incredibly quiet it is. I'm filming under like a flight path and I have to stop all the time with my microphones because of the airplane noise, but if you shut the doors, you hear none of that. And just sitting in here, cars going by and everything, it's remarkable how quiet this is. The quietest of these non-Bentley Rolls-Royce luxury SUVs that I've ever been in. My first real impression has been that it just feels a lot more substantial and more stable than the X5. Not in a bad way, like it feels larger, but the X5 almost just has a mid-size SUV kind of sporty feel to it. This feels more like a luxury vehicle, like has more of that bank vault type feel to it. It does feel heavier, especially going around corners, you can feel more weight, but that also translates to kind of a more substantial, kind of king of the road type of feel when you're just driving along. The same sort of feel that you used to get in Range Rovers. Everything in this vehicle is also incredibly well put together, it's worth noting. Touching buttons and switches, everything feels really, really nice. And this interior, expensive though it is, and I wouldn't pay $5,000 for it, but I like driving it around because everything just looks so nice. Everywhere you look, there's stitching and then more stitching and then leather and more leather and suede. The driving position of this car is absolutely incredible. Somehow I'm behind 20 cars, non-SUVs, and you really do feel tall, high up. More so than in a lot of other luxury SUVs. Now, obviously, I'm curious to drive the V8, but I think it's important to do a review, especially on this car, because more people will get this one. This is the bread and butter vehicle. And it's not like it's slow. 0 to 60 is 5.8 seconds, which is just insane for a vehicle that's weighing in around 5,500 pounds. Just a truly unbelievable number. So do you really need to upgrade to the V8? Well, maybe I'll have to drive the V8 one to find out. All right, accelerating hard on the highway here. It goes, it does exactly what you'd want it to. It feels reasonably quick. It does feel like a big vehicle, and so you need a lot of power to move a big vehicle. The V8's available, but this is going to be good enough for 99% of people who are going to want one of these. As much as I like all the tech that I demonstrated earlier and all of the features and everything, the third row and all the power seats everywhere, I think actually the best thing about this car is the driving experience. I'm really impressed with just the seating position and the feel of driving this car. It gives you that high above everything. Even Honda Pilots I'm behind, I really feel like a more substantial SUV than that. It almost feels like, you know, there's only one real step between X5 and X7. There's not, you know, the X6 is the same size as the X5, but this almost feels like it's a couple grades above an X5.
And so that's the 2019 BMW X7. I know that BMW purists are going to watch this video in horror that the ultimate driving machine brand now makes a massive SUV that weighs 5,500 pounds with kidney grills the size of a capybara. But BMW is smart. BMW goes where the buyers are, and right now, that's luxury SUVs. And this is an excellent one. And now it's time to give the X7 a Doug score.
Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the X7 is handsome, but that controversial grille does detract from things a bit, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Acceleration 0 to 60 is 5.8 seconds, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Handling is normal for the class, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Fun factor is about what you'd expect from a big 7-seater SUV, which is to say, not very fun, and it gets a 3 out of 10. Cool factor is decent enough, same as Range Rover for right now, and it gets a 5 out of 10 for a total weekend score of 22 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. The X7 has some amazing tech, some of the best in the industry, and it gets a 9 out of 10. Comfort is top-notch, not quite on Bentley level, but not as far behind as you might think for about a third of the money of a Bentayga, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Quality is excellent, especially with this interior, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Practicality is strong with 3 rows, and it gets a 9 out of 10. Finally, value, and this particular one is lower than a traditional X7. This one is loaded with options, and it has a sticker price of more than $90,000, which is fine if you're into that stuff, but it gets a 6 out of 10. That number would go up if you're more conservative with your extras. Added up, and the Doug score is 62 out of 100, which is a big deal because that ties the Range Rover. And since you can't get a Range Rover with three-row seating, this is now the best three-row luxury SUV in the business. The X7 just beats out the new Lincoln Navigator, which is also an excellent SUV, but if I were in the market with a big budget, I would get an X7.